Pues yo digo, sacrisa. Es para esa cosa. Mucho gusto.
Okay, it's good. Okay, can I start?
Yeah.
Okay. So today the third part of the Garden of Permutation. And today, essentially, we'll work about Young tableau and Robinson-Sundstedt-Knuth correspondence. So what is a Young tableau? First, you take a partition of N. N equals 12, the partition of N can be visualized as a Ferrer diagram, as we have seen many times before, or partition lambda. And here is the shape of the Young tableau. The shape is going to be the Ferrer diagram of the partition. And the Young tableau definition, it's a filling of this Ferrer diagram with numbers going from 1 to N, where N equals 12 is the number of cells of the diagram. And with the three following conditions, each number appears once and only once. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. until n equals 12. Second condition, the number go increasing in the row from left to right. In fact, strictly increasing, because each number appears only once. Third condition, in each column, the number go increasing from bottom to top. This is a Young tableau of shape lambda on n equals 12 elements. Classical combinatorial problem. What is the number of Young tableau with a given shape? I denote this number by f index lambda. And typically, we want to have an algorithm to compute this number, or better, a formula for the number of Young tableau of shape lambda. And there exists a very nice, very beautiful formula, which is called the hook length formula in 54. So the hook length formula is the following. We have seen with binary tree some hook length formula, which was really easy to prove, but here it's deep formula. First, definition of a hook. You take a cell of the Ferrer diagram, and the hook is all the cell above, all the cell on the right, plus the cell itself. So this is the hook of my cell in purple. And the hook length is the total number of cell of the hook. Here it's 5. So it's a cell of the Ferrer diagram, you can associate a hook length, a green number, and here are all the green numbers, all the hook lengths of each cell of my Ferrer diagram. For example, here it's 8, because 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Here it's 2, because 1, 2, and there is nobody on the right. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So each cell has its own green number, its own hook length. And the hook length formula is the following. The number f lambda of Young tableau of given shape is equal to n factorial divided by the product of all the hook lengths, product over all the cells of the Ferrer diagram. So this is a beautiful deep formula. First, this product, the product of all the green numbers divide n factorial, is not obvious, and the ratio of the two is exactly the number of Young tableau. So example, with this shape, compute the number of f lambda. So f of this shape is equal to n factorial, 12 factorial, divided by the product of all the green numbers. And if you make the simplification, you get 4,455. So this is a product of small prime number each time the number of such Jung tableau. Sorry, not proof in here, this Hooke-Lenz formula. We will prove next week with a determinant and non-crossing path. We'll prove a kind of Hooke-Lenz formula for a more general tableau from which we can deduce this specific Hooke-Lenz formula. So I go to introduction to this classical and very famous correspondence, the RSK bijection. RSK corresponds R for J.W. de Robinson in 38, S for Schoenstatt, and K for Knut. Now S also should be Schutzenberger, as he have done many, many papers in the 60s after the paper of Schoenstatt. He have proved many beautiful things. So let's count. Let's take N equal 4. And take all the Ferrer diagram, all the partition for N equal 4. So there is 5 Ferrer diagram. Below each Ferrer diagram, I put the number of standard of sometimes we say standard Jung tableau because next week there will be some semi-standard Jung tableau. Standard means that every integer appears once and only once. And below I put the number, total number of Jung tableau of each shape. So else you apply your Hooke-Lenz formula, or else you directly you make the list, which is very easy to make the list of all the filling of this tableau of this shape with increasing in row and column. So here the total number of Jung tableau is 10. All Jung tableau with n equal 4 cell. Now if you take the square of each of these numbers, take the square, take the sum, 1 plus 9 plus 9 plus 4 plus 1, which is 24, and this is 4 factorial. So I claim that this is true for any n. The sum of the square of this f lambda is exactly equal to n factorial. N factorial, as we have seen, this is a permutation garden, the number of permutations. So here is a beautiful identity. I am going to prove with a bijection, this is a RSK bijection, that n factorial is the sum of the square of all this f lambda over all partition of n. So what means this identity for a bijective man or woman? It means that there must be a bijection between permutation n factorial. And what means f lambda the square? It means a pair of two Jung tableau of the same shape. If you give a shape, you fill up number of p symbol, it's going to be f lambda. And if you make a second Jung tableau q with the same shape, the two Jung tableau are totally independent. Only relations have the same shape. So the number of such pair of Jung tableau of same shape must be n factorial. There must be a bijection between this and this. And this is the famous classical Robinson-Schoenstatt correspondence between permutation and pair of Jung tableau of the same shape. Or sometimes we say standard, because next week there will be some more general Jung tableau. So we are going to construct this bijection. There is 4 different ways to construct the bijection. Today we'll give 3 different ways, and next time for another way to construct. All the different ways are equivalent. So try by yourself, without knowing anything, to construct the bijection. There's a big, big chance that you are going to fall on the bijection equivalent to one of this presentation. If you give a new bijection, then you will be famous.
So is there a set of axioms for which this is the only possible?
Ah, this would be interesting. This is the only possible. Now we will see next time that in fact there is a general process to construct the bijection, and that modifying this process, you can make an infinite number of bijections, but they all come from the same principle, which is all more or less equivalent. You can modify. You will see next time. So there is not one bijection, there is many, but they are all equivalent. It's something subtle. What is your, Suresh, your question?
Yeah, automorphism, if I take sigma and look at some automorphism of sigma, how will they act on here?
We don't know. It's even some very elementary bijection on symmetry group, it's difficult to say what it happens on P and Q.
But you can see what the shapes are.
But we will see, yes. We can say something, but okay, let's go. So I present the original definition of the Robinson sunset with a sunset insertion. This one is the 60s. So start with a permutation. So here in blue is the indices, and in red the value of the permutation. This is I and sigma of I. Here is going to be the P symbol, and here the Q symbol. So first, you read the first element, is a 3. OK, I put a 3 here, the P symbol, and I put this was the first element inserted. Second element is a 1. I would like to put the 1 on the first row, but if I put a 1 here, it's going to be decreasing. So I put the 1 in the first row, and the 1 is going to bump the 3, which go on the second row. So this is a new cell in the new shape, so I remember this was the second cell. No, third cell is 6. Okay, I can insert the 6 in the first row. And the new cell inserted in the P shape is this one, it's a 3. Now the value number 4, it's a 10. Okay, I can go put 10 in the first row. This is a new cell introduced in P. So you see here, I am introducing the value of the permutation. There will be some bumping process you are going to understand at the end how the algorithm is working. And here, I remember each time I have a new cell introduced here, and I remember each time which new cell was introduced. This is the history of the changing of the shape of the P, and this is the bumping process in this P. So they are totally dissymmetric. The role of P and the role of Q are totally different. Now the next one is a 2. So 2 is going to be inserted in row. So now the role is the following. 2 is going to bump somebody. 2 is going to bump the 6. The rule is that the 2 is bumping the smallest of the value bigger than 2 in the first row. So the 6 and 10, the smallest is 6. So the 2 takes the cell of the 6, and the 6 is bumped on the second row. And then you introduce the 6 in the same recursive as the second row. If you can put it here, okay, it's okay, you can put it here. And the new cell introduced was this one. So I remember this was 5. Now the cell number 6. I introduce the 5, so the smallest of the biggest is 10. 10 is bumped on the second row, and the 10 can be introduced in the second row, and this was a new cell for the P shape. Now 8, good, 8, I can put it here, this is a new cell. Now 4, the cell number, so 4 is introduced here, 4 is bumping the 5. 5 is going to the second row, and now 5 is going to bump somebody. The smallest of the biggest is 6, so the 5 is bumping the 6, and the 6 go in the third row, and this is a new cell introduced in the shape below of the P symbol. 9 go to 9, okay. Now the last one is 7. 7 is bumping the 8. 8 go in this row, so the 8 is bumping the 10. 10 go here on the third row, and this was a new cell introduced. And I finish, I am reading my permutation, and I claim that P and Q are standard Young tableau, because each bumping, it was always done so that they are increasing from left to right in the row, but a little lemma, just check that also the value are increasing in column. At the same time, we keep the value increasing in column. Here, of course, because you introduce 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so this tableau, of course, value are increasing in row and increasing in column. In fact, I have a sequence of Fourier diagram. Each one is included in the next one by adding a new cell. So, in fact, it's a maximal chain in the what we call the Young lattice, the lattice of Fourier shape with in the order relation is the inclusion. And I have here a maximal chain from empty to this shape. Now I claim that this is a bijection. I can go back. So how to go back? The last cell introduced was this one, the 10. So the 10, this was a new cell added. So the 10, this value was bumped from somebody below. So I have to know which value on this row bumped the 10. I claim that 10 was bound by the 8. What you have to take now is the biggest of the smallest value of 10. In the reverse way, you lemma, you can check that it was bumped by the biggest of the smallest value of 10. So 10 was here, it was bumped by the 8, and now the 8 was bumped by somebody on the first row, which is the biggest of the smallest value of 8, which is 7. So 8 was bumped and 7 was introduced in the first row. So the last value is 7. And then you can continue recursively, and you will get the whole, going backward, you will get the whole permutation. So this is a bijection. And so we have a bijection from a permutation to a pair PQ. Very natural question. What happens if you permute P and Q? So what is the corresponding permutation? You have an involution on the set of pairs, so there must be something on the set of permutation. And I claim this is related to the permutation as a group, the group of permutation. There is an inverse in the group of permutation, and in fact, permuting P and Q means taking the inverse of the permutation. And this is not obvious. Imagine sigma here. Imagine we have done all this process where P and Q are totally different way of constructing P and Q. No, interchange P and Q and go backward, make the reverse algorithm by exchanging P and Q, and what you must guess is the inverse permutation. The inverse is just when you suppose you have this card, a vertical card, and you put in increasing order the blue numbers, what you get above is the inverse permutation. So this may be in 72, long time ago, in the note in the volume 3 of The Art of Computer Programming, there is a whole chapter on permutation and Robinson-Chenstedt algorithm. It says the unusual nature of this coincidence, my leaders had suspect there is some sort of witchcraft is operating behind the scene. So I am going to open the curtain and show you who is operating behind the scene by explaining why permuting P and Q is taking the inverse of the permutation. So you are going to give the second definition, another definition of the Robinson-Chenstedt correspondence with some geometric way with light and shadow process. Light and shadow lines. A geometric version. So we go back to make geometry. So we have the permutation which is displayed on the n by n grid. There is one point in each column, one point in each row. So this point means we have this permutation here. And this point means, for example, sigma of 6 is equal to 5. So this is all the point I, sigma of I. We have seen this in the beginning of the chapter. And I'm going to put some light in the picture. Light means that you put a sun somewhere. So there is four corners. There's four different ways to put the light. I will take the southwest corner. I put some light, and if I put the sun here, then I define the shadow of a point. Shadow of a point is all this quarter of the plane, all the points which are on the northeast of this point, which are everything here, everything in this quarter of plane. Like this. So this is the shadow of a point. Definition. The shadow of the permutation is a union of all the shadow. So imagine each point has a shadow. The union of all the shadow is this. You see only two points in full light. All the other points are hidden in the shadow. So this is the shadow of the union. And if you look carefully this shadow, there is a border. There is a border which is this black line. So I define the border of the shadow of the permutation to be this black line which contains two points of the permutation. Now you remove the shadow and look what is below this shadow. What is below is the other point, which are hidden in the first shadow. And then I am going to repeat the process. Imagine you take off this black line with the two points here. You remove this, and imagine you are going to light all this. And then you get the, again, the shadow of the remaining point. you get the border of this shadow, the second lightning of all the points. And below this shadow, there remains some point, which I put again some light. I have the new border of the third shadow, and then I remove them. Then I repeat, and in five lightning of the points, I have finished. Every point of the permutation is on a black line, is on one of the border of the shadow, first, second, third, fourth, and fifth. So I have this kind of picture, and if I follow a black line, there is some new point appearing. The red point, there is some singular point in the black line. All these black points are like this, and there is some other point, which I put a color red on this point. So this red point has a property. If you look, if I take off the black line, this red point has a property that there is at most one red point on each row and each column. It's kind of partial permutation. So you have lost some point. At the beginning, there was 10 points. And the number of red points is the number, total number of black points minus the number of black lines. In each black line, you lose a point and you. In this line, for example, there's three black points and two red points. But because the red point satisfies condition, there is at most one such point in row and column. It's like tower not attacking in the chessboard. So I can repeat with the red points what I have done with the black points. And for the red points, in three times of lightning, I get this, again, this border of shadow for the red point. So if you want to remember the black line, I have a set of black line, a set of red line. And now again, some new point appear, the red point of the red, which I call the blue, in blue. So there is two new point appearing, blue point. Now I can repeat again the process on the blue point. And then there is no green point. The total procedure is finished. I have a certain set of lighting in black, certain set in red, certain set in blue, and then when I finish everything, I finish with this picture. And I claim that what you see is a coding of the permutation. What you see just as this, you don't need to see the whole thing inside. What you see is a coding of the permutation. And I claim that this coding is exactly P and Q. So look P, for example. Look the first line of P, 1, 2, 4, 7, 9. And look the black line here, going outside of the shadow, 1, 2, 4, 7, 9. So the indices of the black line are exactly the first row of P. Now 3, 5, 8. 3, 5, 8 are exactly the indices of the red line, and 6, 10 are the third row, you see. Now if you look here, 1, 3, 4, 7, 9, it's exactly the first row of Q, the red 2, 5, 6, the second row of Q, and the blue 8, 10 is the third row. So I get exactly, because there is the same number of line of each color. In black, there is five line, but there is also five line here. So I get two Jung tableaux of the same shape. And I claim that this is equivalent to the first construction. Before proving the equivalence between the two constructions, I can now prove very easily that this property, exchanging P and Q, is exactly taking the inverse of sigma, because taking the inverse of a permutation is a symmetry to the diagonal. You exchange E sigma I and sigma I and I, taking a symmetry to the diagonal, exchanging this picture, and is exchanging P and Q. So you have a nice proof of this phenomena. So the witchcraft is, now there is no more miracle, but there is some other miracle will appear later. So first, before proving the equivalence of the two definitions, some exercise. So if you take a permutation with a graphic way to write the permutation, this set of black points, the point I, sigma I. So I have this red point. Sometimes it's called, in the original paper, it was called the skeleton of the permutation, going from the black point to the red point. And then the exercise is give a procedure, an algorithm, to construct sigma if you know the red point. You don't need to go through all RSK, all the correspondence. I give you the red points. There is a beautiful algorithm to go back to the black points. Of course, the red points, like this, you see, the red points, there is some column and row where there is nobody, so you have to know the red points plus the grid which is below. The red points, if you reduce the red points to permutation, it's only 5 points. So the red points are like a permutation on 5 by 5, but you have to remember where, which column and which row there is no red points. So in fact, you have to give the n by n grids, the 10 by 10, and if you just know the red points, you can reconstruct the black points. So the exercise is to give a geometric construction. Think of the light, put some light in, and the exercise is solved. You have to put the light in a certain way to get back the black points. Well, there's so many lights that we have to put some shadow in the room. So that's a nice, if you look like this, maybe you will make hours to find the, but there is a certain construction, putting a light and then you get back the red points. So the red points are coded to the blue points are coded to the green points, which are empty. So the empty is coding everything. The green point is empty set, so from the empty set you can reconstruct the blue, but you have to know where are the blue, in which column, which row. So if you know in each row and column are the blue, each row and column are the red, each row and column are the black, this is exactly the P and Q. So exercise, second exercise. It's possible to give a characterization of these red points. I claim that these red points are exactly the set of winning position in a game, the NIM game. It's a certain game. If you like game theory, this exercise is for you. There is a certain game where there is some winning position and there is only one set of winning position, and this winning position are exactly the red points. And the game is played on the Rote diagram. I'm going to explain you the game on the Rote diagram.
What game is it?
I explain which game is it. So here is the Rote diagram. You remember, I have my permutation. You remember, the Rote diagram, each red point is, you put a red point when there is a plumb point of the permutation on the left, and when there is a point of the permutation below. So these red points are in bijection with the inversion pair of the permutation. Total number of red points is going to be the total number of inversion of the permutation. So there's a red point. Each time there's a hook. See, a black point here, a black point here. So there is a red point. So don't confuse the red and the red points of the construction. So now here is the skeleton of the permutation. If I make my shadow process, this will be the point of the skeleton, of this skeleton of the permutation, going from the point of the permutation to putting some shadow. So here are the point, and now here is the game. The game is you start from any point, and you can go to the left. You always stay on the Rote diagram. You can go to the left, or you can go below. To claim that this point, the skeleton of the permutation, are the winning position, means that each time you are on one of these points, if you move left or below, you will get out of this set of winning position. Each time you are outside of this set of winning position, you can go back to one of these points. If I am here, for example, I can go here. I am on a winning position. If I am on a winning position, then I am. And when you are stuck, you win the game. So when I arrive here, I am with the winning. So suppose you start from here, this is a losing position. because from each of these positions, I can go on the left or below. There is always a certain point of the skeleton of the permutation. And this gives you characterization in terms of winning position of game, certain game on this rotate diagram. Well, it's not a difficult exercise, but it's nice to connect this completely different. So more about group theory. Yes?
The algorithm you gave with lights and the shadows.
Yes.
Does the light have to be placed in the bottom corner or can it be placed in any corner?
I don't understand the question.
The source of light can be placed in any corner.
The light?
The source of light.
Source of light?
Yeah, you said it can be placed in any
corner. The source of light is here, yes. This is a black point and this is a skeleton.
If you place it in another corner, you may not get standard tableau.
Yeah. No, I'm
going to
ask what is the relation if you place it in any other corner.
What if the light is placed there?
Ah, we will see. We will see. If you move the, of course, there is some, you can have a, we will see later at the end of this class. If I have time, I will show you. If you put the light here, here, or here, then there is a symmetry of the square, which is acting on permutation. And this symmetry of the square is going to act on pair of Jung tableau. So the, we have seen the diagonal is exchanging P and Q, and there is some other symmetry. And we will see some symmetry. You can transpose the tableau, or you can make the dual of a tableau. So all the symmetry of the square, in terms of pair PQ, is going to be related to a composition of this symmetry, exchanging P and Q, taking the mirror image of a tableau, and taking what is called the dual of a tableau, which, if I have time, I will introduce at the end of the class. So more about group theory. So this is for the Robinson Society correspondence is like an iceberg. Everybody in elementary class can understand the construction with the shadow or with the bumping process between the bijection, between permutation and pair PQ. Even I do this in elementary school with kids, and we have one hour about bumping process, 1 hour about geometry, and 1 hour about what is called le jeu de taquin. So, and below there is some deep things we cannot explain to kids in elementary school. It's a representation theory of groups. So maybe some people here know very well this theory. Some people don't know at all. There is computer scientists, physicists, and mathematicians in this room. So let's say that a group. Well, I suppose a group. Final group is, you know, everybody know what is a group, and we are going. We have a group G, and we try to send the group as a group of transformation to see a group like a group of reflection, a group of symmetry, or a group of matrices, n by n matrices, invertible matrices with n line and n column. So we want to send the group as a homomorphism to the group of matrices, and this is, for example, very important in physics. Standard model of particles, it's related to representation of certain groups and unification of these three force electromagnetic strong theory and strong force and weak force. There is a standard model which is based on some representation of group. Of course, not the group of symmetry group, but it's good to know very well the representation of symmetry group to understand the whole theory of representation of groups. And this is apart from everything, this is the Saint Graal of physicists to have unify all this. This is called quantum gravity. So for every group, you have a representation in terms of a square matrix, and there is some irreducible representation. So else you know this. If you don't know, it's analog to every numbers can be written in a unique way as a product of prime numbers. So every representation can be written as a certain decomposition into irreducible representation. In the case of a symmetry group, the irreducible representation R in bijection with partition lambda of n. And now there is a dimension of the irreducible representation, which dimension means it's the order of the matrix. We are going to send the symmetry group on n by n invertible matrices. And this order of matrices for each irreducible representation is exactly the number of Jung tableau of shape lambda. So in the previous example, there was 4,500 something. So the size of the matrix is 4,500 something. And Jung tableau, because the Reverend Père Jung in Great Britain in the 1920s was studying and making some beautiful theory on the representation of the symmetry group. Now we know that in every, if you know the representation theory of finite group, for any finite group, the order of the group, the number of elements of the group, is exactly the sum of the degree, of the square of the degree of the reducible representation. And so in the case of the symmetry group, the order of the group is n factorial. The degree of the representation is f lambda. Each representation is in Bayesian with a permutation. And so this identity, in the case of the symmetry group, is exactly the identity which we have proved by bijection with the Rommison-Schoenstedt-Knuth correspondence. So without knowing nothing about representation theory of group, we have proved this identity in the case of the symmetry group, which is one of the most fundamental cases in algebraic combinatorics. Now we'll give you the proof of the equivalence between insertion, bumping process, and geometric construction. So here is suppose I have my the whole tableau of the black line, blue line, red line, everything, and I am taking a piece of paper, and I am going to slide this piece of paper like this from left to right. And I am in this process, so it means I have already read in my bumping process the 7 first value. And when I am here, you see this is the process. I am in the process of reading. I have finished to read the first 7 value, which give me this P and Q. And I am inserting the next one, the value number 8, which is 4. So I am inserting, you see the value number 8 is 4. So I am inserting the 4 in this P tableau. And I suppose that this P tableau is a coding of what you can read here. You see, you can read, there is 3 black lines, 4 black lines. The black line 1, 2, this is 5. So the row here is 1, 2, 5, 8. So look, I have this black line altitude at level 1, 2, 5, this is 5, and this is 8. Now what happens when I put a black dot here? So you see the change of colors, it becomes 5. So the 5 is bump. The bumping of the 5 means exactly introducing this red point here. So the 5 is bump, and now the 5 is going to bump the 6. So look, the 6 was red. The 6 was red, and then the 6 is going in the third row, and you see the 6 is becoming blue. So the change of colors, when you read this, and then you read the next column, the changing of colors is exactly a coding of the bumping process in the P symbol. And now what happens when the 6 was bumpier, the new cell introduced is here. So the new cell, you see, it's blue, means the 8 is in the third column. So the color you see here is a coding of the cell you put in the Q symbol. So that's the proof of the equivalence of the two construction. So this is a bumping process, means that you are reading the whole picture from left to right. Each column, the changing of a column is a bumping process. The new color appearing on the top is the new position of the cell of the Q symbol, but you can in fact completely symmetrize the process. So this piece of paper, you can move it like this also. Instead of moving from left to right, you can move it from bottom to top. So you have the dual process of insertion. In fact, you can move in both directions. They have a totally symmetric process between P and Q. So that finished the proof of the two equivalents. So now I give you the third definition of the Rommison-Schoenstedt tableau, Rommison-Schoenstedt correspondence, the jeu de taquin of Souchon B. So without proof. So this section is going to be without proof because it would be a little complicated. So we are going to play the jeu de Taquin. Attends, no, not yet. So you take a permutation. And to go faster in the jeu de Taquin, I am going to put the permutation like this as a snake. Read the permutation. So you have a descent. When you have a descent, you go down. You put the same column. When you have rises, 1, 6, 6, 10, then you go to the right. On 10 to 2, I have a descent. I go down. 2, 5, 8, I go to the right. 8, 4, 4, 9, 7. So what I have done is to put the permutation between two Ferrer diagrams. Now you have this Ferrer diagram, and below another Ferrer diagram. The permutation is squeezed like a snake between the two Ferrer, but I can still read the permutation. And in such a way that you have a, what is called a skew Jung tableau. The number increasing from left to right, and increasing from bottom to top. Amri, you seem to be perplexed about this. So I do this. It just accelerates the process of jeu de Taquin. Descent, rise, rise, descent, rise, rise, descent. So I have put, so my permutation is still, I'm going to do something which I am going to lose some information on the permutation.
So the goal is to have a standard tablet.
Yes.
And when you read it, you should get that. Those two.
Yes, yes. So this is starting point for the jeu de Taquin from the permutation. Now below you have a Ferrer diagram, totally empty cell, and there is some corner in blue. There is some corner on the below the snake, which is formed by the permutation. So I repeat here. So now I am going to do jeu de Taquin, and you are going to choose one of these corners. So I have to put this picture on the. On the other screen. And now you choose one of the corners. You see the corner, one, first line, second line, third line. Allez, give me a number between one and three.
Three.
So you take this corner. Now you see above the corner there is a six. On the right of the corner there is a two. So the smallest of the two is going to take, it's like somebody getting a position. This position was free, and the best of the two takes the position. And immediately, this job is open, and for somebody who is going to take the position. So again, I am going to fill up this hole, this new hole. I have 10 and 5, so the smallest of the two take the position. And then I have a hole here, so now there is no competition. There's only on the right the 8. And okay, now the hole which has shoes is now immersed in the big infinite sea of hole. There was a hole here which propagates inside the, and now the hole is left in this upper part. So I'm going to choose again one of these three positions. So give me a number between 1 and 3, 2. And so 2 is this one, so the smallest of the two takes the position, and now this one is filled. Another between 1 and 3. 2. So 4, 5, 8, 9. Now again between 1 and 3. 1, so easy, 7, 9. Between 1 and 3, 3. So the 1 is the smallest of the two. The 3 is the smallest of the two. Between 1 and 2. 2, so between 5 and 6. And then now between 1 and 2. 2, so this one. 3, 5. And 6. Now there is only one choice. Between 4, 4 and 7, 8 and 10, 2 and 4, 5 and 8, 10, between 1 and 2 is this, between 3 and 5, and between 6 and 10. No, you recognize, if you will remember, you recognize the P symbol of the first algorithm. This was the P symbol of the first and second algorithm. This is exactly the same. So what we have done, first proposition, if you, anyway you do the sliding, you get always the same symbol. Second proposition, what you get is a P tableau, which is exactly the same as the P tableau by the Robinson-Schoenstedt correspondence. So it is the third way to define the P symbol. So we have lots of information. You start from a permutation, at the end have only one tableau. So if you're on the queue, do the same with inverse permutation. So this is a way to define the Robinson-Schoenstedt with the jeu d'attaqueur.
If the permutation is an involution, is there anything special you can say about the initial?
So if the permutation is an involution, means that sigma equals sigma minus 1, and so P equals Q.
But can you say anything about the original strip that you
did? So there is a special, when it's an involution, the diagram is symmetric to the diagonal, and there is a Burge algorithm where you can insert. If you have a fixed point, you insert only one cell. If you have a cycle of length 2, you insert the two values at the same time. So there is a modification of Robinson-Schoenstedt for involution, which proves directly the correspondence between the bijection between involution and Jung tableau, and more, the number of columns with odd lengths will be exactly the number of fixed points of the involution. Maybe, but you have to do the whole thing, even if it's an involution. Maybe there is a direct, I don't know, analog of Burge for the jeu de Taquin. Okay, now with jeu de Taquin, we are able to define the duality on the Jung tableau, again without proof. So now I am going to give an answer to your question. What happens if I do the light, put the light in another corner? What happens if I put the light here, for example? So let's put the light, and then this is the first set of shadow, the black line with the red points. Second set of shadow, the blue points. Now there is some green points. And then there is the yellow points. And I have finished. So we have five colors now. Now here is I put some indices, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10. And then doing the same thing, I have a pair of Jung tableau. So this was the original pair when the light was in the southwest. And this is a new pair when the light is coming from the northwest. Now what you see, this tableau and this tableau, look carefully, this tableau is a transpose of this one. So by transposition, you see, so there was five elements in the first row. Now this explains there is five elements in the first column. Number of elements in the column is the number of light you need, the number of color of the light. So there is five colors for the light. Now between this and this, this is more subtle. And you see, this is a reverse, this is a Jung tableau, but in a reverse way. The value goes decreasing in row and column. So what is the relation between this and this? I need the duality of Jung tableau. I said there was three involution on Jung tableau. There was a changing P and Q. Now the mirror image of a tableau, it's an involution. If you do again the mirror image, you get back this. And now I claim that this is the dual of this one. And if I take the dual of the dual, I get back the original tableau. And all the, if I light in the four different corners, all the pair PQ can be deduced from the one of the pair by applying this three kind of involution, exchanging the tableau, taking the mirror image, and taking the dual. So the dual is a deep property. So now I define the dual. I need a jeu de Taquin to define the dual of a tableau. So let's take a standard Jung tableau. Definition of the dual. you get off the one, take off the one, and then do the jeu de taquin. So two come here, so you do the jeu de taquin, four come, seven, eight, nine. So this cell is now evacuated, and I put back the one on the new hole, but the one, I will not touch it. I put it in a frame in yellow, means I will not touch anymore this one. Now I take off the two, and again I do the jeu de taquin. So three, now five, now eight, and then the two come here. I will not touch the two anymore. I will do jeu de taquin only on the cell which are not framed by the yellow. Now I take off the three, I four, seven, nine, and then I put the three. I take off the four, so five, six, ten, and I put the four. So each time you see, you this is called sometimes remplissage, évacuation. You evacuate the value and you fill up again on the border of the tableau. Vidage, remplissage in French. You evacuate the symbol here and you fill up on the border of the tableau. So you continue, take off the six, seven, eight, now the nine and six come here. Take off the seven, eight, nine, ten, seven come back here. Now the eight come back here. The nine, ten. Now I evacuate the ten and put back the ten. To be a purist, and so that everybody is happy, everybody in yellow. So I have a kind of tableau, a standard Jung tableau, but a reverse tableau. The numbers go decreasing in row and column. Now put this tableau in here, you see, put this tableau here, and see, there was PQ, here before there was a symmetric of this one, but I put it here, and look this one. 10, 9, 7, 10, 9, 7, 8, 5, 4, 8, 5, 4, 6, 2, 6, 2, 3, 3, 1, 1. The column 10, 8, 6, 3, 1 is 10, 8, 6, 3, 1. So now there is really, as Knut was saying, there is really a witchcraft which operates behind the scene. Because I have no simple explanation of this. There is proof of this, but it's maybe above the level of the class, and I give all this without proof, just for the beauty of the of all this story. And, so this is really deep, you see.
So when you
so this tableau, which obtained by lighting on the northwest, is this tableau is a transpose of the dual. I take
the
dual and transpose. And now there is another property that if you take the dual of the dual, so you apply this, but now in a reverse way, you will take the jeu de taquin with decreasing order. If you take the dual of this, this you get back the original tableau. So now we have the total explanation. This is a transpose of this one, and this one is a and this one is the dual of this one. I started from the P tableau, I take the dual, and the transpose is this one. So, now some application of RSK with increasing and decreasing subsequence in permutation. So an increasing subsequence, it's just a subword, a subsequence, so there's a number go increasing, like this one, 3, 6, 8, 9, is an increasing subsequence in the permutation. So, geometrically, you can see an increasing subsequence is a sequence of points. Each point is on the northeast of the other point. This is increasing subsequence. And proposition, when you have the correspondence between permutation and pair PQ, the number of elements in the first row of Jung tableau P and Q is exactly the maximum length of increasing subsequence of sigma. So you have an interpretation of the number of elements, the first row. Number element is you take all increasing subsequents, and the maximum possible length of such sequence is exactly the number of elements in the first row. An exercise proves this proposition. And if possible, by using the first set of lines, the light and shadow algorithm, you just to prove this proposition is not too difficult. You just need to use this. Look at this picture. The number of elements in the first row was 5, because there was 5 black lines. And then from this picture, you can prove that the maximum cardinality of increasing subsequence is exactly 5, the number of black lines. So this is more or less easy to prove this well-known theorem. And now there is a dual theorem that if you know the maximum cardinality of decreasing subsequence, take decreasing subsequence of the permutation, and the dual theorem is says that the number of elements of the first column is exactly the maximum length of decreasing subsequence. Of course, if we know the theorem which sounds PQ by changing light, if we apply this, of course, you immediately get the theorem because it's because of the proposition that it's the mirror image, the dual, all this, so the number of elements in the first column are going to become the number of elements in the first row, and decreasing is going to be increasing. But give a direct proof of this without using the duality property with dual tableau. So to prove this proposition, I give you a hint. Suppose you have a decreasing subsequence of points, the skeleton of sigma. You take sigma, the black point, take the skeleton, the red points, and suppose you know a decreasing subsequence in the skeleton. Then make a construction by light and shadow to define a decreasing subsequence in permutation with one more point. For example, in our example, there was 3 light. There was the black, the red, and the blue. The tableau was with the 3. The first column was the 3 element. So take a blue point. Then you are going to, this is a single decreasing subsequence with only one point. Then you can construct a decreasing subsequence with 2 red points. And from this, go back to the black point and construct a decreasing subsequence with 3 points. So this construction, going from skeleton to skeleton backward, starting from the highest color and going backward, give you the proof of the theorem. As soon as you can give a construction, each time you have a decreasing subsequence with k elements on the skeleton, give a geometric construction with light and shadow to give you another decreasing subsequence on the black point with one more element. Example, you see. I should not give the solution. Okay, now I can prove a very old theorem of Erdős and Szekeres. This theorem says that it's an old theorem of Erdős. And if you take a permutation on the number of element n, which is bigger or equal capital N to the square, then there exists an increasing or a decreasing subsequence of size bigger or equal to capital N. For example, if you have a permutation on 100 elements, you are sure that there exists a subsequence increasing or decreasing of size 10, the square root of the number of elements. And now the proof is the following. This is the proof. If you want, the P and Q symbol of your permutation is all the yellow cell. You have the number of elements is bigger, this is capital N. And the square, so how can you put these yellow things in inside the red things? There must be somewhere, at least if n exactly equal n to the square, so maybe the permutation has a square shape, the P and Q symbol has a square shape, but if in general, so you it's necessary to add new words, so this is the proof of Erdős theorem. I'm sorry, I'm going to finish the 10-15 next minute with only fact without proof, because it's beautiful, but it's really deep. And this is fact you should know in, for the beauty of the combinatorics and all this story. But all this will be without proof. Next time I will give another definition of Robinson-Chernstedt with a so-called gross diagram, local rule, of initiated by Sergei Fomin. So complement the Knuth transposition. So Knuth transposition, suppose you transpose two consecutive elements. And such that on the left of X, or maybe on the right of Y, there exists an element Z. So Z is maybe sigma of I minus 1 on the left, or maybe Z is sigma of I plus 2. And suppose that Z is between X and Y. And you do the transposition. So you transpose two consecutive elements, but the condition that there exists on the left or on the right, another element Z, which is between X and Y. Then the proposition says that the P symbol is invariant. So it's a nice proposition that this is called Knuth transposition. You make transposition of consecutive elements with this condition, and that the P symbol is invariant. But you can say more that all the permutations having the same P symbol can be obtained from one of the permutations by applying this Knuth transposition.
So the Q changes.
So the Q changes. So the number of such permutations, so you have an equivalence class of permutation. All the permutations obtained by doing this Knuth transposition, and this equivalence class is the same as the permutation having all the same P symbol. So the number of elements of this class is the total number of Q symbols, so which is the number of Jung tableau. So the number of elements of the class of permutation obtained by this Knuth transposition is again given by the Hookland formula. So this is a very nice property by Knuth. So you see, Knuth transposition can be visualized this way. You have two consecutive values, like this, with the intermediate value on the left or on the right, which is between the two, and then you make transposition. And the P symbol is invariant. So this was in 70, a long time ago, 45 years ago, and this was the starting point, this property of Knuth transposition. This was the starting point for the famous plactic monoid of Lascou and Schutzenberger. So plactic monoid, there is two different ways to define the plactic monoid. One way is to be inspired from the Knuth transposition. So you do, oh, I'm sorry, I have interchanged the role of Y and Z. This is another, coming from another set of slides. So now I am transposing X and Z, sorry for the change of notation. I am transposing two consecutive values to the condition that there is an Y which is between X and Z. So it's the same thing, except that now I take words where the letters can be equal. I take words on an alphabet. And maybe there is some, it's not strict inequality, so it's words, so maybe there is repetition of letters. So instead of permutation, it's going to be words. Permutation where you can repeat the one, you can repeat many times the two, the three, so I am extending from permutation to words, and I am going to give, I am defining this congruence that I can interchange two consecutive values to the condition that Y, see, there is an equality here and equality here. And I take the ratio of the free monoid of all the monoid, all the set of words, divided by this, the congruence generated by this relation. And this can be defined as a plactic monoid. This is a possible definition inspired from the Knuth transposition. All permutation, if you, in the restriction of a strict equality, you get the permutation, and all these permutations in the equivalence class, they all have the same P symbol.
So if they are distinct, then the number of elements in the plactic monoid is the number of standard tableau.
of semi-standard tableau. Yes, yes.
Yeah.
So this is the second you are anticipating, Amaury, on the next slide. This is one possible definition. This is the second possible definition. That second definition, the plactic monoid. So I introduce semi-standard Young tableau. It's an extension of standard Young tableau. You can repeat the letters. Maybe some letters are missing. See here, the 4 is not in the tableau. The 1 is repeated 3 times, the 2, 3 times. The condition is that is the following. The letters are weakly increasing in row and strictly increasing in column. So this is called semi-standard Young tableau. And then the plactic monoid is the following. You apply the jeu de Taquin. You put the two tableaux like this. So there's a big hole here. And you apply the jeu de Taquin, extension of jeu de Taquin, when some value can be equal. When value can be equal, for example, if there was a, suppose there is 2 and 2 here, then you must have, there is only one way to fill up the hole, because you must have weakly increasing in row and strictly increasing in column. So again, when there is 2 value equal, then you know exactly which value is going to fall on the hole. So you extend the jeu de Taquin to this kind of thing, tableau with repetition of letters. You apply the jeu de Taquin, and what you get here a certain tableau, which is going to be the product of these two tableaux. And this is the second definition of the plactic monoid. The elements are exactly semi-standard tableau, and the product is the jeu de Taquin, what you get jeu de Taquin by applying this. But the deep property is that this product is associative. If you take the product of this by this, you get a certain tableau par jeu de Taquin, and then take the product by this, you get another tableau. And to say the product associative means that if you do first this product, then product this by this, you get exactly the same. So the associativity is a consequence of the fact that any way you choose your sliding, you put the hole, it doesn't depend on the way you are doing the sliding. The final result doesn't depend on the way. So this is one possible way. This is another possible way. Start first with the product PQ, get a Young tableau. Then product this by this, get another tableau. It's the same as taking product this by this, and then product this by this, and this is associativity. So this is another definition of jeu de Taquin. And what we have done at the beginning with the permutation, you remember I was doing the rises, descent, to put permutation like a snake. In fact, the real thing is to start from this, permutation like this, and permutation 3, 1, 6, 10, the product, now it's reduced to one cell. Each of these tableau is one cell, and the plactic product of this cell is going to be the P symbol. That's the plactic monoid, the plactic product. This is it's a tectonic plaque, movement of tectonic plaque. This is called why plactic monoid. And I was doing this to go faster, to go from this to this. But of course, if I was starting from this, we will spend too much time. But originally, this is a plactic. The P symbol is a product of all each value, each individual Young tableau reduced to one cell is a plactic product. And finally, I will finish with another complement, the Schur function, which we will meet again next week with some identity about Schur function. So this is one possible definition of Schur function. Forget it, maybe it's a it's a ratio of two determinants. So it's some polynomial. It's indexed by a partition. It's some polynomial in x1, x2, xn. It's a ratio of two determinants. And these functions are symmetric. Symmetric means that if you make a permutation of the indices of the variable, the polynomial is invariant. In fact, I will use this definition, the Schur function. So Schur function can be defined the following way. It's the sum over all semi-standard Young tableau like this, take a semi-standard Young tableau like this one, and then the weight, I define the weight of the semi-standard Young tableau to be the following. You replace x index I by x index I. So 1 is going to become x1, 2 will become x2, 3 will become x3. So what you get is a monomial for each Jung tableau, semi-standard Jung tableau, where you have a certain monomial in X1, X2, X3, X5, X8. So you make a certain bound on the indices of the variable. Here I have M variable. And the sure function on this M variable indexed by the partition lambda is you take all possible semi-standard Jung tableau of shape lambda, you fill up with the numbers 1, 2, 3 until M, and then you replace each index I by X index I. You take the product of all the variables associated to each cell, and you get a monomial. And the sum of all this monomial is a certain polynomial, which is called another definition of the sure function. So first fact, this polynomial is symmetric in x1, x2, xm, which is not at all obvious from the definition. And this function, they form a basis of the ring of symmetric polynomial. It's a royal basis, really the royal basis. And next week, I will show you the homogeneous symmetric function, elementary symmetric function, to get a proof of the Jacobi identity. This sure function can be also defined as determinant of some other symmetric function. And then there is, as it is a basis, if you take the product of two sure functions, it can be defined as the sum of an other sure function with some coefficient, which are the g lambda mu nu, which depend of the three Ferrier diagram, lambda, mu, and nu. And there is a famous rule to compute this coefficient, which is called the Littlewood-Richardson rule. I will not. This is just to give you the flavor of this beautiful field of connecting Robison-Chernstedt and the theory of symmetric functions. There is a whole book on symmetric functions by MacDonald. So it is to give you in 10 minutes a flavor of this using the jeu de Taquin. And so this can be proved. This rule was not completely proved rigorously in Littlewood. This was in the 1930s. And the rigorous proof is using the jeu de Taquin. You take the product of two Jung tableaux. Each Jung tableau is going to contribute to a sure function. So you have lambda, you have mu, and the product is going to give you a certain semi-standard Jung tableau. And this rule, the Littlewood-Richardson rule, can be, I don't explain the rule, but there is a certain rule to compute the coefficient, and everything can be completely understood by applying the jeu de Taquin on this on these two tableaux, giving a third tableau, and the coefficient J lambda mu nu appear from this jeu de Taquin. So this was some flavor of this very beautiful field relating symmetric function and RSK and jeu de Taquin and plactic monoid. So I'm sorry not to give any proof, just to give you an overview in 15 minutes. And thank you for this class. So next week we go to the fourth